to the March 2015 Poetry Salon at Urban Gallery. Yay! I cannot believe how many wonderful people came out. Blessed and amazed and honored. And, we're going to have lots of open mic. And we've got two amazing features today. Two very strong male poets and musician. Cristofoli and Roberto and Angelis. It's Robbie Patterson?
Yes.
I met Robbie Patterson a week ago. Was it a week ago at one of Norman's salons?
Yes.
Right, and he played a couple of songs there, and he's got a very gravelly, smoky voice.
I was inspired by a film called Moonrise Kingdom from the director Wes Anderson. I've seen the charm of the film. And I liked it. It's about having young love, innocence, and I can really relate to that film. So I wrote a song called You and Me. Thank you.
Jeff in Montreal, who I heard at Lizzie Violet's cabaret. He's really one very brilliant writer. It's got a CD launch next Thursday. On Thursday at the Black Swan. So if you're trying to figure out something to do next Thursday, head over to the Black Swan or just head over there. Put it on your calendar.
Thanks, Brenda. Here's a piece from the CD, and it's an audience participation piece, so I hope you've got a little bit of energy in you. What I want you to do, it's very simple. What?
Can we heckle?
Yes, you may, Norm. You may heckle. But what I want you to do is, I'm going to say a series of statements in character, and if I put my, if I follow it with, by putting my hand up like that, I want you to go, yay. Just a bored, unenthusiastic, yay. But if I wave my arms like this, I want you to clap and go, yay! Let's try it.
Yay.
This is good. I think you're good at this. Okay, this is called politics. I'm going to make life better for every citizen of this community.
Yay.
I'm going to cut your taxes.
Yay.
I'm going to ensure that our community has fresh air, clean drinking water, and a universal power grid run on natural, renewable energy.
Yay.
I'm going to cut your taxes.
Yay.
I won't rest one minute until all the adults in our community, regardless of gender, race, or age, have equal opportunity for employment and education.
Yay.
I'm going to cut your taxes!
Yay.
I'm going to invest in a state-of-the-art transit system that never breaks down or delays or and covers every neighborhood and minimizes wait times.
That does convince.
I'm going to cut your taxes!
Yay!
I'm going to stop all the violence in this community and ensure that everyone feels safe on our streets, day or night.
Yay!
I'm going to cut your taxes!
Yay!
I have a plan to solve the community's homelessness problem in a way that leaves everyone with dignity, self-respect, and affordable housing.
Yay!
Cut your taxes!
Yay!
I'll do whatever it takes to ensure that every member of this community reaches his or her full potential and maximum self-actualization.
Yay!
Blah, 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 cut your taxes!
Yay!
I will somehow find a way to make sure that every member of this community gets laid every single night with Jennifer Lawrence. Or David Beckham, or both.
Yay.
I'm gonna smack every one of these in the face with a waffle iron. And then maybe I'll cut your taxes.
Yay!
Cut taxes! Cut taxes! I'm going to cut your taxes?
Yay.
I hate all of you because you're a bunch of pansy pinko wimps, and I hope you all die alone in horrible agony.
Yay! Tell us off, Kennedy, too.
Ah, fuck with this. I'm going to withdraw from the race and vote for him.
Yeah.
I never said I was going to cut your taxes.
Yay, we love politics.
Thank you, I'm Jeff Cox. Which really means 8:30.
The Black Swan on Danforth at Broadview Station. So. Okay, Kayla. It's Kayla Forrest. Yes. Kayla's. You're still on.
Yes, my second time.
Yeah, she's still almost a virgin. almost only her second time. At Lizzie Violet's last cabaret noir.
I had my cherry pop.
Yes. Kayla got off about her cherry pop. Welcome, Kayla. Thank you.
Okay, so the first one is about an issue that we all know exists, but we tend to ignore it. And it's about homelessness. And just recently in December, a friend of mine and I put together and organized a huge homeless drive. We walked around the streets of Toronto giving out food care packages and clothes to the homeless and shelters. And it's something that not everyone actually pays attention to and walks by and tries to pretend doesn't exist. So this one's called Society Outlooks. You see it every day, people dying, people starving, but you can't do anything, as you think. One day, you may be put there, cold, hungry, and alone. Then the people passing you will say the same. We can't do anything. All you have to do is reach out, take someone's hand. It's as simple as providing nourishment without thinking you provided hope. The homeless are like you and I, but so much stronger, lost in their own worlds, waiting for the day to just drift away. We are all simple humans, just looking for the light at the end of the tunnel. What if we changed society? What if we said that we could do something? And the second one's called Time, and it's in regards to everybody living as if they're immortal and the end will never come for them. Time moves slowly through our hands, slipping through our fingers like whispered words of yesterday's. It cannot be gripped or tamed. It does not obey any of our man-made rules. It changes constantly into nothing we can identify. It becomes a ghost of a ticking time bomb. It can race and slow itself. It's measured by man-made objects. People surround their lives around it, make it their world. Live to beat it with only the greatest of failures. One never will truly know how time really works, nor will they ever learn to slow it down. Things will never be perfect in one's life. You will never get that perfect moment to do or say anything. Nothing is ever a guarantee in life except for time and its forever movement.
Thank you, Kayla. I'm sure we'll be hearing lots more. So we're going to move on to one of our features now, who's come all the way from Hamilton, is that right?
Waterloo.
Waterloo? I thought you were in Hamilton.
No.
Did you move, or you were always in Waterloo? Roberto Angelis' Crucible. Despite a rather secular early childhood, since the age of 10, Roberto was raised under the shadow of a fundamentally restrictive cult, an old world religion steeped in tradition, filtered through a graceless love rooted in fear. He had no TV or other media in this restrictive and abusive environment. He began creating beautiful, broken poetry against the vile words, retreating into his tormented being and immersing himself within sweet symphonies of sound with every connecting blow. He would connect to his deep inner self, drowning out the curses, fists, and buckles with angelic harmonies, celestial woodwinds, and sadly sometimes red violins. Compelled to secrecy out of fear, he went deeper inside himself, where he kept himself alive by writing the whispers of his innermost being. After this period of indescribable suffering, followed tumultuous years of struggling to overcome the demons of his past, which includes depression and even to the point of suicide. We cannot know what burdens and struggles such a man carries, but we can open ourselves to his poetry and really listen with empathy and caring and understanding and let it make each of us stronger in the battle against abuse. Roberto has been described as a truly unique and groundbreaking presence on the music and art scene, and his main themes focus on a truthful portrayal of an innocence lost. There is always a battle within, he says, the antagonist and protagonist vying for a position within the man, as clawing shades of gray warring within an ancient, ravaged soul. Also in his words, I endeavor to embrace the unsung beauty I find strewn amongst the broken pieces of my life, writing the songs and painting the pictures which well up within me. Now, Roberto's publisher won't allow us to video him here, so we'll be turning the camera off. But he's done some powerful video poems. And I urge you to go to his website, robertoangelis.com, and particularly look at the video Heroes. It's absolutely heartbreaking and phenomenally well done. In Roberto's words, let's now place all of our crutches aside and enter the deeper chambers of the heart in our listening. Welcome, Roberto. So, Norman Cristofoli does not like poets' bios, or bios, perhaps. And he just wants you to focus on poetry. And so without further ado, here's Norman Cristofoli.
It's spring. And spring is the real time for love. They say Valentine's Day is Lover's Day, but that's a bunch of crap. It's named after some saint, you know. But in the middle of February, everybody, you know, if you have a partner, you're sort of grumpy and growly, and you can't stand each other because you've been locked up in winter and things like that. So what you really want is to have a day of love when it's spring, when the sun comes out and the birds are singing, leaves start to bud and the trees start to get green and everything is renewal. That's when you want to have a day of love. So I'm going to have it today. And hopefully I'll be able to answer Roberto's question about what is love. This is called Angel. Sometimes it happens just like that. I walked into this bar with a bunch of friends. We all went to hear my buddy Mike, who was playing the blues that night. I love sitting in a warm bar on a cold winter's night, listening to the blues and using scotch to nurse my mediocre life and beer to drown my unfulfilled dreams. I walked in through the door, shook off the snow, and draped my coat over the back of a chair that I was claiming for my own. The introduction started almost right away, because my friends got a whole lot of other friends, and we're all in the business of booze and blues and words to lose. I extend my hand and shake and look up into their eyes and smile, and this happens with one person after another who all seem nice and friendly and homogeneous. And then it happens. I reach out, and there's this one hand that just seems to fit into mine so perfectly. And I look up into those eyes and the rest of the world just seems to fade off into the distance because all I can see are those eyes. And that face, and that wisp of hair that falls across her forehead and down her cheek. And that's it. I know that I've met an angel. And I fall into that moment like I was falling into heaven. Because it's like a halo or a glow that surrounds her and frames her into this focus of complete separation from the rest of the universe. And she absorbs my attention like a magic spell delivered on the point of a lightning bolt. And then my friends start introducing me to other people. Because they can't see what I'm seeing. They can't feel this complete rapture that has engulfed my being. They just want the night to start And I want it to stop right then and there. I want it to stay in that moment of miracles, in that moment of pure, sweet clarity when you know that this is what all those stories and poems were written about. But other hands are thrust towards me like spears at the crucifixion. The angel is moved away in a flood of unwanted handshakes, and then that moment is gone. I'm introduced to other people, and they're taken aback by my apparent snub, not knowing that I'm still in another reality. All they can perceive is that I seem to be ignoring them. But I'm not. Not really. I just want that moment back. The one that was wrenched from my existence like a shark biting off my leg. My instincts tell me to turn back, to chase her down, to totally disregard all of my friends and all of their intentions, to throw away the world that I know and the life that I have built. I look back across the room, and the angel is surrounded by her guards and consorts and mentors, and I look for that sign. For her to turn and look at me and call me with those eyes. Because deep inside I know that with that one look, this world will change completely, forever. Thank you. Take me. Take me like a poet. Speak me with your rhyme. Play me like the music, a symphony sublime. Take me like a dancer, throw me to the floor. Tap across my body, treat me like your whore. Take me like a spotlight to the center of the stage. Write me like a novel, then rip out every page. Take me to the Congo and bang me like a drum. Stomp across my sorrow and tell me I'm the one. Take me full of laughter, alleviate this pain. Take me like the downpour of the sweet torrential rain. Take me like a comet splashing through the sky. Take me without reason and no explanation why. Take me long past midnight and well beyond the dawn. Take me soft and gentle, then explode me like a bomb. Take me like a sadist with a love that's mean and cruel. Take me like a sinner and abandon every rule. Take me to your heaven. Make me feel like Zen. Take me like a lioness and drag me to your den. Take me like a standing ovation. Treat me like a conquered nation. Take me deep into your soul. Take my parts and make me whole. Take me like the morning breeze. Make me drop into my knees. Take my mind until it's clear. Take me far away from here. Take my anger. Take my pride. Take whatever I got inside. Wash me with the morning tide. Bring me back from suicide. Take my virtue and die for me. Open the heavens and cry for me. Take me with insanity, then steal my breath away from me. Open your arms to embrace me. Close your fists and break me. And then remake me. Reawake me. Regenerate me. Inundate me. Confiscate me. Saturate me. Navigate me. Levitate me. Escalate me. Radiate me. Jeff warmed you up with a little bit of audience participation. Now I'm going to ask you to continue that. I just want you to say four words. My heart goes boom.
My heart goes boom.
Now, you're going to say it when I give you the cue. And the cue is thump, thump, thump.
My heart goes boom.
Thump. Thump, thump.
My heart goes boom.
Oh, we got a lot of passionate people out here. You know what love is. That's good. Thump, thump, thump.
My heart goes boom.
Every time I see her, I fall in love all over again. And every time I see her, my heart explodes like original sin. I literally have to hold every single atom in place in order to stop myself from bursting into flame. For this love, it burns like the hot August sun, melting all of my limitations and melting away my inhibitions and burning all the notions that I used to assume. Cupid shot me with an arrow the size of a whale harpoon. Falling on bended knee, I beg her to be her groom. Cause every single time she walks into the room, thump, thump, thump,
my heart goes boom.
She is the temple in which I worship. I spread her legs as if I was opening a sacred book. I reach up and I touch a goddess with my fingers. And that touch goes all the way through me and touches me right to the core of my being, like an angelic dragon flying outside of my room, blowing up the heat of a biblical storm, like a hurricane winds of a majestic typhoon, or the flood of emotions from a blessed monsoon, like thunder and lightning in the month of June, or a sky that's filled with a big orange moon. Thump, thump, thump.
My heart goes boom.
She moves like the thriving pulse of African drums, a kinetic energy that sparks electricity with each kiss. A million drummers pound out the rhythm of our hearts. I fall like a long, blistering guitar solo. I sway to the lullaby of her soul. My sensations explode like cymbals clashing. I want to dive into the heart of her like the deep, deep notes of a golden bassoon and feel her like the heavy thump of a bass guitar that is vibrating through the room. I want to blow her like Dexter Gordon's saxophone playing a long, slow, sultry tune, then thump, thump, thump.
My heart goes boom.
I live for those moments of flesh on flesh, when magic fills the air like a catastrophe about to happen. We splash our colors over the bed like abstract artists in an inspired frenzy, sculpting our desires like a Michelangelo marble, dancing through the hues of unconsciousness and over the brilliant rainbow of euphoria, repeating every word like a sonorous echo. I inscribe my love upon a Nordic rune, cast my bones before Zeus and Neptune, journey deep into the paradise of her womb, open my chest cavity and offer her my doom. Thump, thump, thump.
My heart goes boom.
Van Morrison could be singing on a street corner and I'd walk by without even noticing. Van Gogh could be in my garden painting sunflowers and I'd probably trip over his easel. Freud could be analyzing my psyche and dreams and I would just be mumbling gobbledygook. Einstein could be sitting with me in a coffee shop and I wouldn't even think about asking him about relativity, for I have this heart and it beats only for her. And this head is swimming in a sea of stars when my body suddenly slips into a scientific vacuum and I breathe her in like a sensuous perfume. I reach up and pull my passions out of the gloom and then thump, thump, thump.
My heart goes boom.
A couple more. She has a heart the size of an ocean and her passion could fill the deepest well. I love her because she loves without compromise. She has the sun in her eyes and the moon on her lips, and she feels like the soft reverberations of a piano played at twilight. She smells like excitement, and she feels like midnight. She can break me with her beauty, and she can break me, and she moves me like a storm. She can open me like a volcano and split me like an earthquake. My knees buckle like a falling tree. My legs give way to gravity. My feelings soar, my emotions zoom, and I would bleed for her like a mortal wound. And then thump, thump, thump.
My heart goes boom.
She is my lyric, and she is my rhyme. She is my poem, and I so desperately want to be her. We all have this curse, and she is mine. And I want to hear it softly, so please turn down the volume. Thump, thump, thump.
My heart goes zoom.
Now this one is for me alone, standing here, stripped of all costume. This humble poet sans nom de plume, this enamored, love-struck, bumbling buffoon. thump, thump, thump. This heart. Sun. She left her body and soared, transcending the boundaries of space and time, of reality and existence, of everything and nothingness. Solar flares covered her with a surrealistic rainbows, and the heat burned away her inhibitions and fears. She fell into the sun, and a black spot reached up for her and wrapped her in its darkness and breathed her like the aroma of a conscious death. Wrapped in darkness and surrounded by light, she became a spectrum of improbable possibilities in a focused universe of blind definitions. She fell into the sun, her emotions crumbled like a pillar of sawdust. Visions of the underworld became flesh and blood, her dreams crystallized into amethyst pearls of divine truth, and her love poured in amber teardrops. The darkness pulled her down into an ocean of molten gold, and her existence became a singular moment. She became the music, and she became a poem. She became a photograph of shadows and icicles. She became a sculpture and a dance, and a painting of brilliant colors. She fell into the sun, and she fell into the infinite distance between one heartbeat and another. And she fell into the third eye of her mind, and she fell into the illusion of mystical thought, and she fell into the ritual of pain and pleasure, and she fell into a circle cast by the truth, and she fell into a premonition of a distant universe, and she fell into the 72 names of God, and she fell into a pile of leaves that had fallen from the tree of life, and she fell into my arms, like falling into forever.
Two heartbeats. It was beautiful. Thank you, Norman. We're going to finish with a whole pile of open mics, which is going to be fabulous. So, Valentino
Assenza
is a brilliant trombone poet. He's also taken over Howl. Is it back to being called?
Yeah, as of March 31st, it's going to be.
So he does a spoken word music and poetry on C-I-U-T. C-I-U-T. I always do this. Every other Tuesday night at 10 o'clock.
That's right.
Yeah. So welcome, Valentino is going to do open mic.
Okay, all right, thank you.
Dropped your pick.
Okay. So yeah, Norm was saying that spring's coming, so things are going to start growing. And this was a poem inspired by things growing, I guess. You told me to come by and look at the sunflowers. You said you wanted me to see what I had planted. You said that some of them had grown 7 feet tall and that I had to see it for myself. Your backyard incubated the small relationship I had with flowers. Sunflowers. Those were my favorite because they have obvious personalities and it seemed that they were always in good moods. The picture showed a happy family with big yellow smiles. I remember that day. Followed it. Glided on its timeline as though it was how it was supposed to have happened. You were hobbled. Perhaps it was an exertion of inspiration or passion. I carried the heavy bags of soil to the backyard. You showed me how to spread the earth evenly, how deep to dig, and how delicately to let the seeds fall from my hands. Later, we chewed through medium well steak and buttered potatoes and allowed ourselves the luxury of profanity in our conversation. Through a finger of scotch and a projection screen, we watched Buster Keaton exude the locomotive that is the general. I left that night to a walk along still air. I levitated just above my mattress, kept fatigue at bay, and thought about the relationship between gardens, parents, and their children. How my grandfather always used to hold up his tomato plants with hockey sticks I wished I could have used. How I'd run from my mother at the first mention of gardening. How Vito Corleone died in the garden while playing with his grandson. And how in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus knew he was out of options, did what his dad told him, and followed the passion of prophecy. And tonight, while looking at the pictures of these sunflowers, I reflect on your ability to cross realms and enter other dimensions. I know that it's not so easily accessible, that it's a lost symbol or a tongue spell that opens up that door. And I picture you there, playing possum with Buddha, flirting with truth, and waiting for the sorceress's robes to blow open. I know there was a time when God took you by the hand, showed you how to spread the earth evenly, how deep to dig, and how delicately to let the seeds fall from your hands. It came in the form of ink droplets and precious virgin thoughts. And I know there'll be a time when the telescope will point in the other direction. God will take you by the hand and show you how you connected the celestial dots in your sleep and then present you with one of your very own. There'll be a mirror in the sky from when you reach that certain altitude. And he'll tell you that you have to come over, that you have to see it for yourself. And he'll take you by the hand and show you what you planted. Thank you.
Arlene, she's a beautiful singer, and Dakota's going to play her name. And you're doing the CBC contest or something. So it's Arlene Paculan.
Paculan.
Paculan. And did you go every day and go to school?
I think so.
Okay, she's doing the CBC contest.
Wait till you hear. Go in and just, you know, give her some support.
She's got one CD out.
So yeah, EP.
Which I have, and it's fabulous. And you can get it from iTunes, I think.
I have a couple here too.
And you can get it from her website, so you can just download onto your device and go walking around and listening to Arlene's best.
Thank you very much. I'm going to share a song called He Got Me. And Roberto's going to.
What a voice, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm an actor.
I can't.
Okay,
do a little ballad.
Joe, where's Joe? Right here.
Nancy Jane. I apologize. Nancy Jane is having, she's an artist and she's having a show here in September. So I'm looking forward to that. And Calvin was talking to you and found out Joe was a poet and said, come out to the Poetry Salon, so welcome. And you can see what a lovely space this is, huh? Yeah.
Well, thank you. It's a privilege to be here. I'm Joe, and here's 5 minutes of my life. 20. Strange. More than bread alone. It says, for loss of myth we must atone, or fear to burn, or just give in and float through time forever. That's plenty for today, I'd say. That's plenty for today. Strange. Such strange terrain to range, riding on a question, or seize up dumb. Done now, downed now, and downed forever. That's plenty for today. I believe that's too much for today. Strange. How we reason we can see, yet resonate with mystery. Strange how vibrations make sensations rise as thought. Voltaire's children set adrift on rafts of reason. I'd say that's enough for today. Except your eyes. The message surfing down the line of sight through smiling eyes till I explode and hear your song. That's plenty for today, my love. Loved plenty in each day. Music for deckhands. Between lines of myths and poems, tapping crude rhythms on a cracked kettle, gratefully bewildered on the near side of rejoicing, just passengers in our unlikely home, wobbling through heavy traffic, beaming messages at rocks. Carnival. This atavistic madness. Villagers rolling about, pants down, skirts up, heads in buckets of ribaldry. Love. A Bosch grotesque step from a Bruegel market comes dancing, ticking, twitching, jerking down our street, saucy, coy. Empowered with images of distant hopes for which words have not yet formed, exhausted in its contemplation, excited to feel something beyond the coil of us matters. How I know. Help. Probably it's what a guy like me would need, but I wouldn't recognize it. I think you'd best not waste the effort. You'd be upset, because I despise it. I could never know how I'd grow, except against the wall. Just wits and will. No depth at all to grow eccentric. So surprised to be okay with banging at the wall. It's the space between that's been my all. Between me and the wall. Weightless in my own free fall, wondering if the crash is all. Not like a bird, more like a stone. Galileo's ball or Newton's apple, thinking up new laws, I grapple with a sense of fifth dimension, a giddy sense of apprehension that I will fall apart before I understand at all. Now this last one may need a little context. Driving with a colleague on a throughway on a business trip, stopped at a bar. I'm thinking about my ex-wife and her home with our kids. echo. I heard the poor dog long before I saw him between the lanes. Someone had stopped. I read they died. The dog howled as we passed on the shoulder to shop, I guess, or write a poem next day, mid echoes from all corners of the globe. But on a different frequency, I watched you going about attending, contributing, directing traffic.
Almost a virgin too. This is her second time on open mic, and the first time was Tuesday night. So give me a hand.
I love it.
Hello. This is about the visceral feeling as a writer or as a human soul. Can't hear that inner voice that you long to hear. Inside this cold skin, I pull the sheets around me tighter. I take another dry breath, waiting for the door to nothingness to open. Swallow me whole. In the eerie quiet of this faded room, nothing seems to breathe anymore. It's just like that dead beetle in the corner, the one with the shiny skin, the silver markings on its blackness. I look over at the cluttered bedside table. Chipped coffee mug, full ashtray, the disarray of dusty magazines, the clinging threads of sticky cobwebs. I don't know if I can lift my fingers to clean up this mess. The crumbling chaos assaults my tired senses. I am frozen. Staring at the waste. Inside this inert silence, old thoughts loop uselessly in my head, the same old vowels caught in my throat. I long for the silver sounds of inner whispers to bring me new words. But I hear nothing. I sit on this silent plane of futility, waiting for a hint of breath that could wake these slumbering words from their place deep beneath the earth, so they could take form and be written in visible ink in a language I can taste with my tongue. But the words hide in the darkness, the cold cement walls of waiting have no answers. That voice I used to feel seems forgotten and lost, like footprints washed away by the tide. No sound. No call. The dead bell is no longer ringing. Something bright flickered once, like those tiny glowing insects dancing in the dark forest. But now it's crumbled like the ash of yesterday's fire. And the memories have blown away like specks of dust. Even the light of the night sky seems like distant history. the memory of stars that vanished millions of years ago. What robs this present moment of life? Is this stagnation built from my fears? What lies beyond the fog of this mental numbness? Could there be a firelight I can't see? Could there be a possibility I can't see? In the earth, there are tiny things that don't sleep, turning the soil over and over. Is there a ghost stirring to life beneath the ground? I'm sitting here in the dark, waiting for the seed of spring to burst its seam, waiting for the weeping to end. Is this inky darkness a wall or an opening? I can't see. I can't see yet. Something gently brushes me, like fine-boned fingers of understanding. But it's such a delicate touch, I could easily mistake it for nothingness. Can I wait with patience in this eternity instead of just going back to sleep? I don't know where this story is going. I don't know how it's going to end. I don't know where this meandering madness is taking me. I can't see. I can't see yet.
You're from Moscow?
Yeah, from Moscow. It's my very fresh, very new translation of Pushkin. It's a melancholy poem, name of poem, Incantation. This poem has very interesting history. German philosopher Friedrich Nietzsche was a composer at the beginning of his life. Loving very much Pushkin, he set these lyrics into music. And you can listen in YouTube to the Nietzsche's romans called in German, Lisch World. It's German. Okay. My translation. Oh, if it's true that in the night the rest hugs all who are alive, beams of moonlight from sky arrive, to stony graves, to light, to slide. Oh, if it's true that all the graves are washed away by stony waves, oh Layla, your grave is filled with foam. And now, know your home, come to me. I'm dead, rise from death, my friend, and come again for our farewell. Pain, icy cold, to our love's sad end, a mirror image of our merciless hell. Or come, like a far lighting star, like an idyllic music with sea breeze. If you find gas, now you are, come anyway, I'll cease. I shall see you, but not to blame your torturers who crucified your soul, no. I do not condemn all of them, a coffin's mystery is not my goal. I have my melancholy death someday when I'm lost. But anyway, my wish to say I'm yours. Love is life, and you to me, Layla. Come to me, I pray. Thank you.
Translating Pushkin. Fantastic. And choral. You ready?
Okay, let's go practice, okay?
Okay, Cottrill Excompare?
Yes, Excompare.
Most beautiful lady.
Thank you. Thank you for this opportunity.
Yeah, she almost hosted today, but she thought she was doing a...
I'm doing my acting course, the boot camp.
The boot camp for acting course, and then it got rescheduled. But so we're lucky to have both and her daughter tell me. Yeah.
Thank you. This one is called Hand Me Downs. I know you've taken to wearing around your father's hand-me-down anger, but I wish that you wouldn't. It's a few sizes too big, and everyone can see it doesn't fit you. Makes you look silly, hangs loose in all the wrong places, even if it does match your skin color. And I know you think you'll grow into it, that your arms will fit after all the fighting, that it will sit on your shoulders if only you could pin it in the right places with well-placed conviction. The bathroom mirror tells you you look good in it, makes your fists a lot more justified. So when you dig your fingers deep into the pockets, you'll find stories he left there for you to hand out to the other boys, like car bombs. For the days when everything else is slipping through your fingers, this you can wrap yourself inside of. This will keep you warm at night, help you drift off to sleep with the certainty that no matter what, it will still be there when you wake up. And the longer you wear it, the better it starts to fit, until some of those stories are your own. Maybe the holes in the sleeves are from the bullets you dodged yourself. So when it rips, snags on the barbed wire fence of someone else's family, don't worry, because your mother and sister will help mend it. Patch up the hole, sew the tears, replace a button or two, help you back into it and tell you how proud they are of you, how good it looks on you, the same way it did on your dad and your granddad too, and on his dad before him, and on his father before him. But back then there was only sand, until someone drew a line, someone built a wall, someone threw a stone. And the crack in the skull that it hit fractured perfectly outward, like twigs on the branches of a family tree, and someone threw a stone back. And every fracture, every tiny break, wound itself together into thread. The thread wrapped itself around your great-great somebody. And on the other side of the wall, they were knitting just as fast and theirs fit just as well, only a slightly different color. So I'm asking, when the time comes, who will be the first one to put down the needle and thread? Who will be the first one to remember that their grandfather suffered just as many broken windows, broken hearts, broken bones? The first time you come down to dinner and your son is sitting at the table with your hatred on his shoulders, who is going to be the first one to tell him it's finally time to take it off?
So I guess there's a couple. But this is an older piece. It's called The Lace Maker. And it's kind of a prose poem, I guess. Lace Maker. In a moment, words will appear from which everything unravels. Or begin with an explosion of lace. Lace that is white, or whitened with the sun steaming, looped, twisted, braided threads, sewn with sharp needles, shaped like a cut work of leaf veins in the sky. Finely woven stitches, not broken or lost, florals in white, sun rises in white, waves in white, spider webs of lace floating, an organic garden of cotton and linen and silk. How many fine stitches we see everywhere. Seams of perfect clothing, backs, shoulders, arms, waists, hips, the tight stitching of form-fitting shoes, the interlapping folds of purses, fabric like skin, woven tightly or loosely, draped, tucked, formed, fitted, the soft velvet of the armchair in the cafe in which I sit, rounded, plush, sewn.
colors and swaths, patterned, different attire for different scenarios, layers of warmth or mere covering, if it's cold or hot, whether a garment can open or close, or covers in one swoop. Pieces of cloth fitted to hold the shape of the wearer. Clothes that adhere, drape, flow for sitting, walking, sleeping, dancing. Looms and sewing machines and bobbins, billions of miles of thread around the world, stitching this way of composing, holding together, covering ourselves, these metaphors, textual narratives. What if I don't want to take a stance? What if I don't want to weave a garment out of these threads? A story out of all the stories filling my mind. If, quote, narratives, or more precisely plots, synthesize reality, can I exist without telling a tale of myself to you, or even to myself? The flow of language, like clothing, fashions that encase, shaping how we present ourselves. Can we be naked without the speaking that stitches the world together, seam by seam, reams of bolts of cloth, patternings? What was lost in the scrap lace pile? Discarded, worn out, old, the remnants, unraveled in the tears and rips, bleached out by wear. How do I hem these words so they don't fray? Shawls of Shetland lace are knitted first in the middle and then out to the edges, and it is so fine it can be pulled through a wedding ring. Can we marry ourselves to words that knit us to ourselves, each other, the world? Social customs inform the entire of any given era and shape the body. But does the weave of worsted wool or soft cotton follow the curves and hollows of the skin and shape the wearer? Or are the words we clothe ourselves with what we hide under? Presentation and fashion, the way I compose myself every day, every piece of writing, gathering myself in this historical time, a product of my age. All the stitches of the world held in syntactical rhythms of meaning, social fabrics. Is that why we want words to unfold in comfort from us? Wave white words wedded, words that aren't performative, that are dreamlike, real. Unraveling, I came to this. And I can't obscure it. Truth, death, the words of the lover, and she who knits, knots, tapes, crochets, sews the world into being with her open work, the lace maker.